Hey guys, my name is Derek, and I'm so glad you chose to worship online with us today. God knows exactly where you are, and He wants to move in your heart and in your life. You're not here by accident, and no matter what burden you have today, you don't have to keep it. God is so much bigger than our circumstances, and He can change absolutely everything about our lives. Let me pray for you. God, we just thank you so much for your love and your peace and your mercy and your grace and how Christmas perfectly packages all of those up. God, and for the times we have walked right past that love and that peace and that grace you offer, we stop today, Lord, and we invite it into our hearts and into our lives. In the places, God, that we've reserved and kept from you at times, we open those up today, God. Examine us, search us. May we know you more. May we know that love. May we know that peace. And for the rest of our time together today, Father, we just commit it back to you. It's in your name and for your glory we pray. Amen. If you want to know more about Jesus or to talk to someone at any point during our time together, feel free to comment in the live feed or send us a direct message. Again, we'd say it a million times if we could. We're so glad you're here. Before we continue with worship, I want us all to be in the know what's going on at First Ridgeland. First up, peace on earth for all is happening next Sunday, December the 20th. I don't know about you guys, but I'm ready for some Christmas music. And packed with soul-stirring worship in a variety of styles, ballet, kids choir, and a full nativity processional, you do not want to miss this year's Christmas worship experience. There'll be three chances for you to join us, either in person or online, at 9 a.m., 10:30 a.m., and 5 p.m. Due to COVID, seating will be limited and tickets are required upon entry, but don't worry, they're totally free. Now for some insider info, I know two of the services are nearly full, so go ahead and save your seat today at firstridgeland.org/peace. Next up, there's only one more week left for Project Christmas Cheer. COVID has impacted us all. Do you know specifically of a family that's struggling to make Christmas a reality this year? If so, we're here to help. Just go to firstridgeland.org/cheer to nominate someone today, and we'll get the cheer rolling. Next up, we want to finish 2020 strong. Did you know that we collect nearly 30% of our ministry budget in the month of December? And as a congregation, we have a very good history of rising to the challenge. Realizing everything you have belongs to God anyway makes giving back so much easier. So here's a brief update on where we are. Regarding our $1.3 million annual ministry budget goal, we've received over $1,080,000, leaving $220,000 to meet our goal. Be praying about what God would have you give between now and December 31st, and log on to firstridgeland.org/give to finish strong. Last but certainly not least, let's take a look at First Ridgeland's verse of the week.
Thanks, Mr. Derek. First Ridgeland has committed to memorizing a new verse every week because we believe God's Word is living and active. And when we take time to think about what He says, we become more like Jesus. Let's read this week's verse together. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people." Luke 2:10. When the world needed a Savior, God gave us the best present ever, His only Son. Jesus chose to live with us and become human so that He could one day be the perfect sacrifice for all our sin. This is really good news for you and me. We don't have to live in sin anymore if we give our life to Jesus and trust what He has done. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for this wonderful church that I get to grow up in. And amen.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know? has come to make you new. This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with his hand? Did you walked where angels trod, and when you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God? Oh, Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you is heaven's perfect land, and this sleeping child you're holding is the great.
Hey, good morning, friends. Thank you so very much for tuning in via a live stream. And listen, I want to thank you. I have had the privilege over the last couple of months of meeting some of you in person that typically worship online. You were in town visiting your family, and you were able to worship in person. And I just want to say thank you for introducing yourself to me, and please continue to do that in the future. If you have any prayer needs or anything that we can help you with to stay connected, please share that in the comment section, or if you would prefer, just call our office and we'll get back to you as soon as possible. Okay, we're in week two of our series, Lights, Camera, and Christmas. Lights, Camera, and Christmas. You know, this time of year, Christmas time, and then you combine COVID-19, it's easy to misplace things, is it not? I mean, it really is. Things like your car keys or maybe the remote control, or for me, my reading glasses. I mean, it's just really easy to misplace things. And when they're small, well, that's not a really big deal. However, if you lose things of significance, it's amplified this time of year, isn't it? It really is. The most obvious thing would be if we lose a loved one to death. Or maybe it's a relationship that has come to an end, or a job that's come to an end and followed by financial reversal, or maybe it's the loss of your health. And if we lose too many things, the sum total of the weight of that loss, if we're not careful, it can bury us. And that's what happened to old George Bailey in the famous classical Christmas movie, It's a Wonderful Life. You know, George lost a lot. Even at an early age, he lost part of his hearing. And then when his dad passed away, well, the board for the building and lawn company that his dad worked for, they tagged him to run the company. Opportunity lost. He was going to travel the world. Fast forward a few years, his brother comes home from his service, and he's supposed to relieve George, and hopefully George can travel the world. But he had a surprise, didn't he? He introduced old George to a beautiful young bride. In addition to that, he wouldn't be working at the building and lawn company. He was going to be working for her dad. Opportunity lost. And then the turning point in the whole movie, George's uncle comes to him frantic. George, I misplaced $8,000. And then who would appear on the scene but Mr. Potter, the town bully, who owned almost everything in town save George's building and lawn company. He would remind old George that he held the insurance policy, $15,000, on the company. And the sheer weight of all that was just a little bit too much for George, and he was about to do something desperate. Here's a picture of old George on a snow-covered bridge crying out to God. Jimmy Stewart's the actor there. What can I do? God, help me out. Show me something. And then right after this scene, his guardian angel, old Clarence, would appear on the scene. Would he not? He would give George a new perspective on what life would have been like in Bedford Falls had he not come around. And our main idea today will help us do the same thing. We can focus on what was lost, or we can build on what remains. I really believe that this statement is a great summation, a bow, if you will, for 2020. I mean, this is the year of the pandemic, COVID-19, and we will be dealing with this well into the spring of 2021. And so we really have two choices. And fortunately for us, we have choices, don't we? We can focus on what was lost, or we can build on what remains. And I believe that you want to build on what remains. And our focal text is going to help us do that today. It's Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. This is part of Matthew's account of the birth of Christ. And I want us to pay particular attention today to Joseph's role. Let's begin reading, if we can, in verse 18. And this is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. And because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. Very important. We're going to unpack that in a minute. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. Verses 21 through 25. She gave birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Verses 24 and 25. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and he took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and she gave him the name Jesus. He gave him the name Jesus. And as we look at this text, wow, there are some incredible lessons here that will help us build on what remains. I'm going to introduce you today to three truths. Here's the first truth I want you to remember. We can look within. As a matter of fact, building on what remains, well, it starts by looking from within. That's exactly what George Bailey did in the movie. I mean, when his uncle came to him with a seemingly unsolvable problem, a shortfall of $8,000, man, George just faced the problem, did he not? He did. And in so doing, he would face the town bully, Mr. Potter. He would face him down. He would ultimately save the company, the building and loan company, and in so doing, the livelihood of his fellow townsmen. And Joseph did much the same thing, especially in verse 20. The Bible says that after he considered this, well, what did Joseph consider doing? Well, in verses 18 and 19, the Bible says that because Joseph was a righteous man, that means he was a man of integrity, specifically he walked rightly with God, that he didn't want to expose Mary to public disgrace, so he had in mind to divorce her quietly. Now this says a lot, because a look within ourselves starts by examining our own character. Examining your character is another way of saying you're examining your motives. Why are you doing what you're doing? And because Joseph was a righteous man and he walked right with God, the reason that he did not want to expose Mary to public disgrace, if a woman was found in first century time to be with child before she was married, look out. It was scandalous. Now, at a minimum, she could be ostracized from her community. But at worst, she could have been put to death. Joseph knew all that. He simply was going to issue a divorce, a quiet divorce. No, there wouldn't be any rumors, nothing like that, just a quiet divorce. But then in verse 20, after a sleepless night, the text says, after he considered this, an angel of the Lord would speak to him and encourage him, tell him, it's okay, you can take Mary home to be your wife. And what did Joseph do? Well, Joseph stepped out in faith instead of stepping back in fear. He stepped out in faith instead of stepping back in fear. And history would be forever changed because he did. In 2020, man, we have seen people do both and, have we not? We've seen people step out in faith and step back in fear. On a national scene, we've seen people, I mean, they've stepped out in faith, specifically healthcare workers, doctors, nurses, administrators. They have stepped out in faith and cared for those with COVID-19 in heroic fashion. And then still there have been others that have stepped back in fear. There have been others that have made poor choices on top of poor choices, not just on a national scene, but even in our own state and perhaps even in our own community. A look within starts by examining. It starts by being self-aware and taking personal responsibility for where we are in life, and then building on what remains. Consider for a moment that we are still living through a global pandemic. This is not a localized disaster like with a tornado or a hurricane that we're accustomed to, unfortunately, in the deep south. This is a global pandemic, and our country has been hit especially hard. There's absolutely nobody that has been unaffected. As I'm preaching this sermon right now, I have been praying for this today. People who are in the hospital that are battling COVID. There is no industry, there is no school or university or sports team or church or government or company that has not been affected in one degree or another. And so a look within, it starts by being self-aware, taking personal responsibility of where we are, and then building on what remains. And I like to ask myself a question whenever life gets a little bit crazy, and it's really can be stressful, which much of 2020 has been. Here's the question. What do I reach for in my hour of need? I mean, when I'm really feeling the pressure of life, when you're really feeling the pressure of life, what do we reach for? And quite simply, if it's anything other than Christ Jesus, then we need to allow Him to hit the reset button in our life, don't we? We do. Because if we're reaching for anything or anyone other than Jesus Christ, our priorities are misplaced. So a look within starts by being self-aware of who we are and what we are and where we're going and building, taking personal responsibility to build on what remains. That's reminder number one, a look from within. Here's reminder number two, a look ahead. You know, George Bailey in the movie A Wonderful Life, he got an unprecedented look into the future. Now, bear in mind, it was a movie, but nonetheless, his guardian angel, old Clarence, gave him a walk around Bedford Falls with what life would have looked like had he not showed up. And guess what? It wasn't a pretty picture. He began to realize that his life meant something. His life made a difference in many people's life, and Joseph would do the same thing. You know, initially, when Joseph learned that Mary was with child, he thought, well, that's going to be a Mary deal. That's why the Bible says that he didn't want to expose her to public disgrace because he was a righteous man. And he thought to divorce her quietly because it was a Mary deal. It had to be a Mary deal. That was the only plausible human explanation. But when then the angel shows up and he's like, no, you can take Mary home as your wife. Then it becomes a Mary and Joseph deal because he obeyed to do that. And then when the angel said, but you're going to give him the name Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. So it moves from a Mary situation to a Mary and Joseph situation to a global situation. It becomes very apparent to Mary and Joseph that Jesus is God, a sovereign God's solution to his redemptive plan to reconcile a lost world back to a just God. Wow. So in just a short night, the situation with Mary being with child went from Mary's deal to Joseph and Mary's deal to a global situation. Jesus would in fact be God's redemptive plan to reconcile a lost world back unto Himself. You know, we can look at 2020 in one of two ways. We can focus on what was lost, or we can build on what remains. However, with every challenge, there are always new doors of opportunity, aren't they? Absolutely. With every challenge, there are new doors of opportunities. And we can either check out or we can step up. We can check out in fear or we can step up in faith. The choice is ours. And when this pandemic hit, I was so encouraged by new ministries that were being born all over our city, all over our state, all over our country. And you've heard me say before that we've been on the front lines as a congregation of many needs in our community. LifeServe Sunday, the food pantry, just to name a couple. But people in our community and in our state launched brand new nonprofits. And here's what they were doing. And some people, there weren't even nonprofits. They just did it out of the goodness of their heart. They would take groceries. Different people around our city would take groceries to senior adults who were shut in and couldn't get out. They would go get their medication and bring it to them. And in some cases, which is really cool, they would just visit with them through the front door, the glass front door. To give them some companionship because they were so lonely and just desperate to interact with someone else. So a look ahead, it involves looking at life beyond your little corner of the world and seeing it through God's eyes. And look, 2020 has been tough, but when we do that, we realize, oh wow, there's something greater at stake. We get to point people to Christ. Exactly. And when life seems impossible and when fear looms large and our faith seems small, maybe we can go back to what God said to Abraham. Remember what God said to Abraham? He said, look toward heaven. And what was that expression for? As numerous as the stars in the sky, so would his offspring be. So a new perspective fuels our resolve and reminds us there really is more to 2020. There really is more to 2020 than being inconvenienced by a pandemic, than wearing a mask and having to remember the social distance and all those things. There's so much more to it. And what's that something more? Well, like Mary and Joseph learned, it's to point people to Christ Jesus. Because, see, it wasn't just a George Bailey situation. It wasn't just a Mary situation or a Mary and Joseph situation. It was a global situation because Jesus was God's solution, His redemptive plan to reconcile a lost world back to Himself. And as His church and as His children, our new perspective reminds us, it fuels our resolve, and it reminds us to point people back to Him. That's reminder number two, a look ahead. Here's reminder number three, a look above. One of the more tender moments in the movie, It's a Wonderful Life, the very end of the movie, and you know, it's a Christmas movie, so all ends well, right? George Bailey's holding his beautiful daughter in his arms. He's standing at the bottom of the staircase in his home and right by the Christmas tree. All of his friends are there, and it's an incredible scene, and the little girl hears a bell ring. His daughter does, and she says, Daddy, Daddy, did you hear that? Every time a bell rings, an angel gets their wings. Every time a bell rings, an angel gets their wings. And old George Bailey says, that's right, honey. That's right. And he looks up and he winks and he says, way to go, Clarence. Way to go. After the angel of the Lord came to Joseph, the Bible tells us in verses 24 and 25 that he did exactly what the angel told him to do. He took Mary home as his wife. He did not have marital relationships with her until the baby was born. Then he gave the baby the name Jesus. Jesus. Why? Well, because he was going to save his people from their sins. Please note, like Joseph, everything that we do, everything that we do has eternal implications on the line. Our attitude, our words, our motives, our actions, everything that we do. Listen, that is so very easy to forget, but imperative to remember. Everything that we do as Jesus followers has the potential to point people to Christ or away from Christ, to give them a good taste of what it means to be a believer or a bad taste of what it means to be a believer. And such was the story with a little girl from Alabama named Allie Cheeks. Allie's a cute little girl. She's a 7.5-year-old little girl in Alabama. And she's actually like a lot of kids her age, save one huge thing. She has a very rare genetic mutation disease. So rare, in fact, only 50 kids in the world have it. So Allie's mom and dad and Allie have lived with the reality that, well, every day's a gift. She probably wouldn't live to see her 8th or 9th birthday, and so they've made the most of every day. And it happened. The doctor's visit happened that Allie didn't have but maybe a few months left, and so mom and dad came to her late in the fall and says, look, what do you want to do? Let's just live life, enjoy life. What do you want to do? And little Allie says, well, I'll tell you what I want to do. I want to see some Christmas lights. And the mom and dad looked at her and said, honey, it's still October. And she says, well, you ask. I want to see Christmas lights. So they went to their neighbors on November 1st. And they said, look, don't judge us or call the Homeowners Association, but you're going to see us putting up Christmas lights on November the 1st, and here is why. It's for Allie. She just wants to see Christmas lights one last time. Well, as you might imagine, one neighbor said, well, I'll put up Christmas lights. Another neighbor said, well, I'll put up my Christmas lights for Allie. And before long, wow, the whole loop and the whole neighborhood was lit up with Christmas lights for Allie. There was one neighbor that even loaned them their golf cart so the parents could drive Allie around. They would bundle her up and drive her around so she could enjoy the Christmas lights. And because we live in the world of technology, somebody took a picture of the Christmas lights and what they were doing and put the hashtag lighten the loop for Allie. And wouldn't you know it, it went viral. So much so that people all over the country were decorating their neighborhoods with Christmas lights early, sending the photos to Allie's mom and dad so she could enjoy them as well. There were even Christmas wreaths sent to their home from countries all around the world, from Italy and from Spain and Peru, all just to bless Allie. And as you might imagine, a national news station found out about this and ran the story, sent a reporter to interview the mom and dad, and here's what the mom said. She says, you know, Christmas is about Christ being with us and Christ being in us. And seeing what everybody did in our neighborhood for Allie and for her to enjoy this reminds us of what Christmas is all about. And the mom took the reporter and a watching world back to Christ. You know, that's exactly what happened in the movie It's a Wonderful Life. Very similar to what happened to Mary and Joseph. The Son, Jesus, the Savior of the world, would in fact be God's answer, His redemptive plan to save a lost world. Right about now, it's easy to focus on what we lost in 2020. But I want to encourage you to build on what remains, and to do so by looking above and around, and to be encouraged and reminded that God is still God. He's still very much on His throne, and He wants to use you to point people back to Him. Let's bring this home with a question. Are you focusing on what was lost? Are you building on what remains? You know what? I really believe the vast majority of you have stilled your resolve to build on what remains. And we're here to help you do just that. Perhaps you've made decisions today. If so, I want you to text Next Steps, one word, to 95577. Next Steps to 95577. You know, in our text, it says that Jesus will save His people from their sins. Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. Jesus will save His people from their sins. The Bible even says that everybody who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. It simply means that we admit our sin separates us from God, believe that Christ died for those sins, and then commit our lives to Him, and then we come alongside you and help you to solidify that faith story and to grow in your faith. Or maybe you've just hit the reset button today. Maybe you have been focusing on what was lost, but now today is a new day, and you're resolved to build on what remains, and we're going to help you do just that. Let's pray. Lord, You're good, and You're great, and we love You because You first loved us. God, help us to take what You've taught us from Your Word today and point other people back to You. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for that message, Dr. Bird. We can choose to focus on what was lost, or we can build on what remains. Let's close today by saying our relational commitment together. You will never suffer at my hands. I will never say nor do anything knowingly to hurt you. If you're down and I can lift you up, I'll do that. I will always, in every circumstance, seek to help and support you. If you need something and I have it, I'll give it to you. No matter what I find out about you, no matter what happens in the future, either good or bad, my commitment to you will never change. Thanks again for joining us, and have a great week.